Hello, Farmington, and welcome to the possibly the best part of your Friday morning. Today is October 11th, 2013. I'm Christian.
And I'm Sam. We have a variety of stories for you today. But first, here's Christian with our top story. Christian?
Thanks, Sam. An undercover New York police officer was among three people charged on Wednesday in a connection to the case of an SUV driver being swarmed by motorcyclists earlier last week. He was charged with riot and criminal mischief. He was also spotted on a video taken at the scene of him bashing the rear window of the SUV after the high-speed chase.
A 9-year-old Minnesota boy who flew to Las Vegas without a ticket reportedly been investigated by social services after he stole a car and sneaked into a Minnesota water park without paying. On the way to Las Vegas, the Flewcrite became suspicious during the flight because the boy was not on the unattended minors list. The boy also has a history of riding trains to a Bloomington water park, where he waits until a large family is entering and joins them. The case is still being reviewed by the Child Protection.
That's crazy, Sam. I mean, how can a 9-year-old boy slip past all the security in Minneapolis Airport?
I don't know. They need to figure that out.
It's crazy. Currency collectors sure are getting their money's worth. The Federal Reserve Board released its new redesigned $100 bill. The new look has a splash of color and style flourish the ever-familiar Benjamin Franklin face. The bill also has a large number of upgrades that prevent counterfeit bills from being made.
You know, Christian, speaking of money, to keep you, the viewer, informed, here's a bit of United States trivia for you. The national debt on January 1st, 1791 was just $75 million. Today it rises by that amount every hour or so. Currently, our national debt is over $16 trillion. To see a real-time clock of our national debt, log on to www.usdebtclock.org.
Well, I sure wish I got $75 million a day, Sam. That's a lot of money.
You can do a lot with that money.
If there is one person who can bail us out of anything, it's Maddie Allison with our weather. Maddie, tell us about our weekend forecast.
It's going to be rainy with a high of 73 and a low of 47. Saturday, it's going to be partly cloudy skies with 61 and a low of 36. Sunday, partly cloudy again with a high of 59 and a low of 37. Monday, going to be a kind of a rainy Monday. It's going to be a high of 53, a low of 41. So it's an iffy kind of start out of the week. Tuesday, we have a high of 51 and a low of 38. So it's an okay start out of the week, but it'd be nicer if it was sunny out. But on to my shout out of the week. My shout out of the week this week is to Mr. Williams, because of those people that don't know, he was a teacher last year for history, and he was in this program called Bridges. But now he's a counselor, and he hosts a lot of clubs like Diversity Club or Military Club. So if you want to know more about those, go talk to Mr. Williams. But that's all for my weather this week, so back to you guys.
Thanks, Maddie. Christian, what do you have there?
It's Mr. Itachi's iPhone.
Are you trying to break it or what?
No, I'm trying to bend it. It's not working. That's right, a bendable smartphone. Interested yet? LG announced this week that they have started mass production of the world's first flexible OLED panel for smartphones. The company hopes that its flexible screens will hit the shelves sometime next year, and the curvy screen will not just be for smartphones. The chief tech officer, Dr. Sang Diagio, says the company expects the technology to grow quickly and will expand to automotive display tablets and wearable devices.
Wow, I wish I had a phone like that.
Yeah, wearable devices like a watch. I mean, it's crazy what the technology will be coming up in the next couple of years.
Exactly. Chicken nuggets, you either love them or you hate them. Medical researchers recently bought a box of chicken nuggets from two national food chains, the names of which they won't disclose. After examining under a microscope, the researchers found that the nuggets were about 50% muscle tissue, such as from the breast or thigh. The rest of the meat was made from fat, blood vessels, bones, and nerves, specifically the cells that line the skin and internal organs of the chicken.
Well, I don't know. That's a lot of chicken. I mean, I don't know.
Yeah.
Other health news this morning. Raw chicken has been pinpointed for salmonella outbreak. Health officials urge consumers to cook their chicken thoroughly and take precautions after an 18-state salmonella outbreak that has made hundreds sick in recent months. A health alert has been issued for raw chicken packaged from three foster farm facilities in California. 278 people have fallen ill since the strain of salmonella was first detected in March 2013.
I'm not sure if chicken's going to stay in my diet.
Yeah, I don't know. That's pretty serious.
There's crazy stuff going on.
Yeah.
A lot of crazy chicken. Remind me to stay away from chicken.
Yeah, stay away from chicken. Dominic Benedetto joins us now for a look at our sports. And it looks like the Minnesota Lynx have had a great run this week, Dominic.
Yeah, the Lynx actually, came through huge last night in Atlanta. All five starters scored in double figures. The final score was 86-77, and it's their second WNBA title in 3 years. The Lynx dominated the postseason, winning all seven games. But let's talk about some Farmington sports. The Farmington girls swimming and diving team are having a great season. They took on Shakopee Tuesday in a dual meet, looking for their seventh win in eight tries in dual meet competition. To the Dodge Middle School pool we go. The girls' 500-yard freestyle event was dominated here by junior Kristen Cracky. She started the race with the first lap of 29 seconds. She finished first with a time of 5 minutes 40 seconds and just 10 seconds in front of fellow teammate Ellie Sundet. The 200-yard individual medley showed Tiger fans that the future is bright. Here we get a look at the speed and versatility of 8th grader Catherine Gerke, as she would swim hard and place second in this event behind senior Caitlin O'Reilly. Gerke finished with a time of 2 minutes 29 seconds. To diving we go. The Tigers would finish 1-2-3. Here's sophomore Tori Sontag with one half backflip dive. She would take the third. Next is senior Nikki Kayard with a 1.5 backflip. Swimming's pretty great. Looks like they're getting some hustling out there. Now to diving we go. It's a great 1.5 backflip dive there. Farmington beat Shakopee 93-83. Now let's talk about some Farmington football. The Tigers were hoping to get back to their winning ways Friday at Tiger Field. The Tigers unveiled a new rockin' statue Friday night, hoping to beat Chanhassen with no score in the first quarter. That's a pretty awesome new statue rock we got there. Right, look at that Tiger. All right, so we got Tyler Werke throwing to Johnny Dittman, taking it down to the 1 yard line in a slant pattern. Two plays later, we'll see in a minute, Van Winkle calls his own number, bringing up the middle, and touchdown for the Tigers. With the score still 7-7 in the first half, the Tigers line up to what appears to be a long field goal attempt right here, which then appeared to be fumbled with a pass then thrown by Dittman, which was swatted down. Dang. Really had them hopes up for those guys. Chanhassen dominated the third quarter with the handoff to Ryan Lasue, galloping 12 yards into the end zone. He would have 193 yards for the night and got the lead for Chanhassen, 21-7. Tigers would fight back later in the game. Late in the fourth quarter, Van Winkle rolls to his left and finds DeCrook for a 7-yard touchdown pass. Sadly, it was the closest the Tigers would get. The night ended with Chanhassen winning 21-13. The Tigers play Holy Angels tonight in Richfield at Stardome. Make sure you guys go on and cheer the Farmington Tigers. Quarterback chaos. The Vikings signed Josh Freeman on Sunday, adding a third quarterback to the Vikings roster. Freeman practiced for the first time with the Minnesota Vikings on Wednesday, 3 days after he was signed to eventually be their starting quarterback. Leslie Frazier says he is not starting Freeman in this week, but after this weekend, all bets are off. The Vikings are playing the Panthers this weekend, so it should be interesting. Tiger boys soccer team played Section's 1A playoff game against Rochester John Marshall last night. After a 1-1 tie in the first half, the Tigers went to work in the second half. Here off the free kick line of Captain Blake Smith, Jeffrey Gutierrez pounces on the rebound to make it a 2-1 Tigers. A few minutes later, a great crossing pass by Ryan Parko. He hits Tigers' leading scorer, Jared Wolt, for the header goal to make it to 3-1. Then towards the end of the game, Zukowski puts a ball out in front, John Marshall 4-1. The girls also played a team from Rochester. Rochester Century came to town. After trailing early in the game, the Lady Tigers would go to work. Check out this awesome passing. Shannon McKnight hits Nicole Doran in stride for the one-timer and the goal to tie. The Tigers then cheering that goal, really great. Then Kelmio picking it up out of the air to deliver the goal, 2-1 Tigers. Later, a corner kick executed to perfection by Kaylee Allard gets a piece of it for the goal, making it 3-1. Then with about 15 minutes left of the game, Then 15 minutes left of the game, junior Megan Graham launches a shot inside the left post for a goal as the girls move on in the 1AA playoffs, beating Rochester Century 4-1. That's all for sports.
Thanks for that awesome sports news, Dominic.
Yeah.
I think we did great. Speaking of soccer, Evan Lamphere takes a closer look at this year's boys team.
The Farmington boys varsity soccer team has had a good season so far with a record of 6 wins, 4 losses, and 5 ties. The team is built up of young players and veterans. One of the younger players, Ben Sorensen, says he has been playing since he was a little boy.
I've been playing soccer since I was about 4 years old. It's a good group of guys, you know, it's a lot of fun. When practicing, we all just kind of mess around, but we actually get stuff done while we're messing around. I mean, like, it's a fun experience. I like Coach Buss a lot, and he said it himself that Coach Buss sets up things while the captains will do a lot of plays, and so really it's the captain's coaching, while Coach Buss is really, he's really informational, but the captains will set up the drills, and they're awesome guys. I mean, they know a lot about the sport and they teach you a lot.
I've been on the boys varsity soccer team for 4 years now. Coach Buss is definitely not one of the, he's more of one of the stranger coaches. He doesn't really yell from the sideline. It's just, he tends to stay more quiet and doesn't get all up in your face when you do something wrong. But he's a really nice guy. I like him as a coach, so. There's really nothing to do outside of soccer. Soccer is basically 24/7. But otherwise, I go to church. I help out throughout my community and run track. I think our team is doing great this year. We, even though we've ended up with a lot of ties where we don't want to have a tie, but we started out the season very strong and we haven't completely lost it like we have in the other seasons where we've just gone downhill after the first few games. So the fact that we're still going strong and we finally got our first ever home section game for the tournament is just great.
Reporting for Tiger News, I'm Evan Lamphere.
Those are some awesome soccer team shots. Stay tuned. We will be right back with a special guest, Invisible Blood Drive, live when we come back.
Hi, I'm Rachel.
And I'm Jessica, and we're a part of the Gay Straight Alliance here at Farmington.
We will be sponsoring Ally Week, October 21st through October 25th.
Ally Week is a week where students are encouraged to sign a pledge stating that they'll be allies to the LGBT community.
Being an ally means accepting these students and standing up against any form of bullying or harassment towards them.
After all, school should be a safe place for everyone. Pledges will be available at all lunches during the third week in October. If you're looking for more information, you can find it at the GLSEN website. That's GLSEN.
Signatures would be greatly appreciated. Thank you for your support and participation.
Power Rangers headquarters. Yep. Okay. Okay. Power Rangers, we have a code green. You know what to do.
Red.
Gold.
Pink.
Blue.
Power Rangers.
That does not go in the organics.
Chip bags are not compostable. Trash this.
These are not compostable. Remember, friends, be smart and be green.
Whoa.
Be smart. Be green. Brought to you by the Mean Green Recycling Team.
Welcome back, Farmington. At the beginning of the school year, Mr. Tschida, our new athletics activities and administrator, joined the ranks of Farmington High School. For more on this, Long Lam joins us now with Mr. Tschida. Long?
Hi guys, I'm here with our new AD, Mr. Tschida. And how are you doing, Mr. Tschida?
Good, glad to be here.
All right, why don't you tell us a little bit about yourself?
Sure, my name is Bill Tschida. I grew up in St. Paul, Minnesota, attended Creighton High School. I'm married. I have three children. My oldest son, Patrick, participated in football, basketball, and baseball. He just graduated from college with a sports management degree. My daughter, Emily, participated in high school in volleyball, basketball, and softball. She's a sophomore at St. Ben's. And my youngest son, Nick, who participated in football, hockey, and baseball in high school, is now a freshman at Augustana in Sioux Falls, where he's playing football. I've been an AD for 15 years, so I'm excited to be here at Farmington and kind of get my career going here.
All right. So what were your first impressions of our high school?
I've been very impressed. I mean, certainly when you walk in, the first thing you notice is the facilities, and the facilities are wonderful. But there's a lot of great people. The administration has been great to work with, the coaches. The students are very respectful, very cooperative, so I've been very impressed with that. My administrative assistant, Karen Donnelly, she's kind of the backbone of the office. She's great to have around because she knows the ins and outs of things, so she's been a great benefit to me so far. I'm really excited about the fan support, the super fans that we have. The kids do a fantastic job. They were responsive to a couple requests I had for them, so I really appreciate that. We had a great night last night with the boys and girls soccer team winning. We had a great crowd. The marching band was there. It just was a great environment. So it was really, really a neat experience. It's fun to see all the great things that are happening at Farmington.
Yeah, we do have a pretty awesome high school. So what kind of role do you think extracurricular activities have in our high school?
Well, I think extracurriculars exist to enhance the whole high school experience. So that they're there to support and enhance the curricular piece. It gives kids an opportunity to be involved in things that they have an interest in or they have a passion in. There's also a lot of life lessons that we learn when we participate in activities that are things we take on and use over and over again. And so those things are wonderful to be a part of, and to watch kids grow in those things is great. The other thing I always want to emphasize to kids is that extracurriculars are a privilege, not a right. And you have to earn those privileges by, your academic performance obviously comes first, and then your personal behavior is also important too, because we want you to represent yourself, your family, and the community at the best you can.
Mm-hmm. So, as you know, we are going to be going into the South Suburban Conference next year. What are your thoughts on that?
Yeah, South Suburban, I think is probably recognized as one of the best conferences in the state of Minnesota, so it's going to be an opportunity for I to kind of measure up with the best of the best. So I think that some of our programs, when we step into that conference next year, will be able to compete just fine. I think some of the programs that we have might need to probably put in a little more elbow grease to be able to get to that level, but I think the neat thing about it is, again, to measure yourself against the best of the best. That's a great challenge and a great opportunity for everybody involved in the extracurriculars. You know, they also want us to add some activities that we don't have. For example, chess club, science Olympiad, debate. So there's a few more activities that the South Suburban has that they'd like to see Farmington add, which is provides more opportunities for students at Farmington mm-hmm. High School.
Mm-hmm. It's going to be tough, but I think we can do it.
Raise the bar. That's going to be my theme for next year. You know, we need to raise the bar, and I think we'll do fine.
All right. I think that's all the time we have for today. So thank you, Mr. Tschida. Back to you guys.
Thanks, Long and Mr. Tschida. A new clue has been given about a $14.3 million lottery ticket jackpot in Iowa that was initially claimed, but then unexpectedly abandoned. The unidentified man in Canada gave information to the Iowa Attorney General officer, pointing to a possible lead in Houston that officials hope will solve one of the strangest lottery claims in 26 years of the Iowa State Lottery. The ticket was unclaimed until a customer claimed it with an anonymous trust. The trust proceeds would go to a corporation in Belize, a country that is a large tax haven. Lottery officials refused to pay the jackpot until names were announced to everyone who possessed the ticket. The rightful owner later withdrew the claim, and the $14.3 million was forfeited. Officials say that this is an act of attempted fraud.
That's just crazy.
Yeah, that is nuts. As you all probably know, today is Farmington High School's annual blood drive, which is now taking place in the gym.
We have Cora Cobb down in the gym via FaceTime. Cora?
Blood drive. Here we have Miss Humbert. Hi guys. Let's put on our blood drive. Love can come down and blood. We still have some spots available for the afternoon session. Like to come on down? Come on down. Feel free to stop on by Miss Johnson or myself and get you a pass out. Come down here from class, and then we'll get you all set up to donate. Thanks, guys.
Thank you. Okay, and then we're gonna go over to the Red Cross representative. Tell us what she does and how the process works. Hello. Here's one of our Red Cross representatives. Tell us how it works.
We apologize, we appear to be having some technical difficulties. So we leave you today with the Farmington. We leave you today with the Farmington Girls Swim and Dive highlights from Tuesday evening.
Have a great and safe weekend.